Dreamscape presents The Divine Dance by Richard Rohr with Mike Morrell. Narrated by Arthur Morey. Introduction. Six Impossible Things Before Breakfast. The Blessed Trinity is supposed to be a central, even the paramount, foundational doctrine of our entire Christian belief system. And yet we are told, at least I was told as a young boy in Kansas, that we shouldn't try to understand it. Just believe it, we were admonished. But there it stopped. Irish-born Sister Ephraim just held up the shamrock to my totally trustful third-grade class. We surely believed, if not in the Trinity, at least in her earnest Irish faith. Although maybe that is exactly how the divine flow has to start, with sharing a bit of earnest and deep goodness. Yet it was indeed a mystery, sort of a mathematical conundrum to test our ability to believe impossible things to be true. You would have thought believing six impossible things before breakfast was the actual goal of my pre-Vatican II Catholic training. But later, I found my Protestant friends had approximately the same approach to faith. It merely involved different impossibilities, usually things that happened in the Bible. They didn't seem to appreciate inner experience too much either. And here I am, some 60 years later, presuming to try to breach this impenetrable mystery. Shall we dare to try? I suppose this is the only real way we can join in the dance. Trinity, MIA. Let's begin with the shocking and oft-quoted idea from Karl Rahner, the German Jesuit who was such a major influence at the Second Vatican Council. In his classic study, The Trinity, he said, "Christians are, in their practical life, almost mere monotheists. We must be willing to admit that, should the doctrine of the Trinity have to be dropped as false, the major part of religious literature could well remain virtually unchanged." We would have to admit this was largely true until William Paul Young wrote his worldwide best-selling novel, The Shack, in the past decade. For the first time since 4th century Cappadocia, the Trinity actually became an inspired subject of conversation and rather pleasant questioning in homes and restaurants. And it continues. But 17 centuries of being missing in action, how could this have been true? Could this absence help us understand how we might still be in the infancy stage of Christianity? Could it help explain the simple ineffectiveness and lack of transformation we witness in so much of the Christian world? When you are off at the center, the whole edifice is quite shaky and unsure of itself. If Trinity is supposed to describe the very heart of the nature of God, and yet it has almost no practical or pastoral implications in most of our lives, if it's even possible that we could drop it tomorrow and it would be a forgettable, throwaway doctrine, then either it can't be true, or we don't understand it. Since you're listening to this, I'm going to guess that somewhere you believe it must somehow be true. In the pages that follow, I'm going to simply circle around this most paradoxical idea about the nature of God. And in truth, circling around is actually an apt metaphor for this mystery that we're trying to apprehend. There is no other way to appreciate mystery. Remember, mystery isn't something that you cannot understand. It is something that you can endlessly understand. There is no point at which you can say, "I've got it." Always and forever, mystery gets you. Circling around is all we can do. Our speaking of God is a search for similes, analogies, and metaphors. All theological language is an approximation, offered tentatively in holy awe. That's the best human language can achieve. We can say, it's like, it's similar to. But we can never say, it is, because we are in the realm of beyond, of transcendence, of mystery. And we must, absolutely must, maintain a fundamental humility before the great mystery. If we do not, religion always worships itself and its formulations, and never God. The very mystical Cappadocian fathers of 4th century Eastern Turkey eventually developed some highly sophisticated thinking on what we soon called the Trinity. It took 3 centuries of reflection on the Gospels to have the courage to say it, but they of this land, which included Paul of Tarsus before them and Mevlana Rumi of Konya afterward, circled around to the best metaphor they could find. Whatever is going on in God is a flow, a radical relatedness, a perfect communion between 3, a circle dance of love. And God is not just a dancer. God is the dance itself. Now, hold on to this. This is not some new trendy theology from America. This is about as traditional as you can get. Here it is, in the words of Brother Elias Marischal, a monk at the Monastery of the Holy Spirit in Conyers, Georgia. The ancient Greek fathers depict the Trinity as a round dance, an event that has continued for 6,000 years and 6 times 6,000 and beyond the time when humans first knew time. An infinite current of love streams without ceasing to and fro, to and fro, to and fro, gliding from the Father to the Son and back to the Father in one timeless happening. This circular current of Trinitarian love continues night and day, the orderly and rhythmic process of subatomic particles spinning round and round at immense speed echoes its dynamism. Here it is. The circle dance of the Trinity is very traditional language. And yet, if I showed the same courage to use such a risky theatrical word today, I would probably be called New Age, an esoteric, or a heretic. Yet God is the dance itself, they said. A space at God's table. Let's observe this divine dance in an enigmatic story from the very first book of our sacred texts that we call the Bible. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw 3 men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat, so you can be refreshed and then go on your way, now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered. "Do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get 3 seahs of the finest flour and knead it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. This account gives us a lot to chew on. The scene is set up as the Lord appearing to Abraham, but in the realm of discernible form, those appearing to him are seen as 3 men. In the centuries of reflection, theology, and storytelling that have followed this original story, these 3 are often regarded as angels, and perhaps something more. Abraham, bowing low before them, seems to intuitively recognize this something more and invites them to a meal and a rest. He does not join them in the meal, but observes them eating from afar, standing under a tree.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.